again. I'm Dr. Aeon, and I'm welcoming you to the very first experiment in making a battle report in this channel. Now, I've been reluctant to do this because I don't really feel I have the equipment to do it, but I'm going to give it a try anyway. It's going to be perhaps a bit unusual. It's going to be very cut up because I can't film for long stretches at a time. And so I'm only going to show you the most important parts of each turn and do a lot of cutting. The other perhaps a little bit odd thing about this is because it's my first experiment, I'm going to try to play solo. I'm playing Strange Aeons, and I'm playing against the game. I don't have an opponent as such. I'm using this deck, the solo play deck, which will, through the flip of cards, control what the opponent is doing. So I'll be playing the Threshold Agents, and this deck will be playing the Lurkers. And these symbols will tell me approximately what to do. For example, this symbol means which lurker model to nominate. It means to nominate and activate the lurker model furthest from a threshold model. This symbol means he's going to do a cautious advance. He will attempt to move into cover unless he's charging. And this symbol means that he will, if possible, attempt to complete a scenario objective, whatever that may be. And also it gets, in some cards, a special characteristic here. Well, practically all of them have some special thing they get to sort of compensate for the randomness, for the fact that they're not behaving very intelligently. They get bonuses. So, let's see how this goes. Now, the very first thing we do in a game of Strange Aeons is to select the scenario. There's a special list for this for the solo game, so I'm just gonna roll 2 dice and get a result of 9, which is the Bagman. This is a scenario where, as the threshold, I have to nominate select one of my models as being the bagman, carrying the bag, and the objective is to get that model off the opposite table edge, the one controlled by the lurkers. The next step is to create the lurker list, and well, because it's my first game, I've created my threshold crew as well. I've made a 15-point total group here, consisting of one character and named Evelyn, and 3 agents, Harry, Faye, and Howard. I'm gonna say that Howard is the bagman because he's unarmed, so yeah, that's a good indicator. I'm gonna keep him safe. So I've made them from a total of 10 personnel points and 5 equipment points. And the reason I'm kind of metagaming a bit here, because I know that once you survive a single scenario, you can upgrade equipment to a total points of 20, of which 10 can be personnel and 10 can be equipment points. And so I thought it would be best to actually have the maximum number of personnel to start with, and they're a bit under-equipped, but they'll get better equipment later. Now, the lurker list I've made is composed of cultists to 15 points. We have a cultist leader, we have 2 cultists armed with knives, 2 armed with handguns, and a henchman who is also armed with a knife. I mean, the model has a cleaver, but I didn't have the points for that, so it's just an ordinary knife in gaming terms. Now, the setup of the map, it says, is controlled by the lurkers. The lurkers set up the map and set up on any edge they wish. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up terrain thinking as if I was the lurker. I'm going to try to optimize it and make it as difficult for the threshold people as possible. Be right back.
So I've set up the board here, and I've used my entire table here, which the mat is 3 by 3 feet. My table is about 2.5 feet wide, so it's 2.5 by 3. It's supposed to be 2 by 3, but oh well. I've set up the lurkers over here, and I've made the terrain so that it will funnel the threshold agents. They have to sort of run the gauntlet between these difficult terrain types and then have to disperse in among the buildings and the farm here. And this will provide more opportunities for the threshold player to actually, the lurkers to actually block the advance. And each side sets up within 5 inches of their edge. And it's time to roll for initiative. I'm going to use red dice for the lurkers and green for the threshold. And initiative on turn one is threshold. Well, calling it initiative in turn one is... I'm so used to how other games do it. I have to start using the terminology from this game. Once you start, you always alternate turns. So first turn will be the threshold, second lurker, third threshold, and so forth. But the difference between this game and many others is you can't activate all your models every turn. You nominate, as it's called here, one model and one model only. Now the trick here is that some models have a skill called command. My leader here, my character, has the command skill, which means if I nominate her, I can sort of group nominate two more models within 10 inches of her. So that's what I'm going to go ahead and do. Now, because the opposition is so far away, it's, 26 inches to the nearest lurker. What I'm going to do is I'm simply going to do a lot of movement. And I'm going to move, Now I have moved three of my models 10 inches because the basic movement characteristic is 5, and any nomination means you can do 2 actions. In this case, I've simply done 2 moves because the enemy is so far away. And I've left my bagman behind for a little while, but I've made sure that he is within 10 inches of my character so that she can nominate him to move up later. Now, time to flip a card and see what the lurkers do. The weakest link. Looks like they've identified your least experienced squadmate and are sending in the big guns to take them out. Okay, I'm going to activate the lurker model with the highest point value, which is going to be the cult leader, because he's worth 5.5 points. He's going to do a cautious advance and target the threshold model with the lowest total point value. Now the lowest point value is Howard back here, and they can't actually get to him. So I'm going to nominate the cult leader because he has the highest point value. So he's going to group nominate because he has the command ability, his two closest buddies. And I've measured it so they can't, with one move, get into range to shoot. None of the guys with guns have the range. So I'm going to do 2 moves and try to get them into cover. However, I'm not going to move. I'm going to try to be a bit smart about this. I'll show you. So I moved up my cult leader here a very short distance, staying covered behind the doghouse. The reason is I want to keep
the rest of the cultists within command distance. However, the two others moved up here on the flank, trying to gain a little bit of cover behind these woods and, well, you know, cover the flank. Well, that's them. Over to the threshold.
No, wait.
Sorry, I forgot the special thing that this card said. This model adds 2 inch to its movement characteristic this turn. That's useless for the leader, but I'm going to say that this is a transitive property, so it carries over to the group nominated, and they can move another 2 inches. Now, this guy can only move like an extra inch, because then he start going into terrain, which costs more movement. This guy can like one, two, can get to there. And so they're a bit more covered. Now it's the threshold.
Now for the threshold turn, I'm once again going to nominate Evelyn here. And she in turn is going to nominate Howard and Harry, who is off to the side here. Faye is going to stay in place, and that means a rule comes into play called alert. If the model is not nominated on its turn and doesn't move and doesn't do anything, it is sort of on overwatch, so to speak. It's ready to take a shot if something shows up that could possibly be dangerous. So let's move. I'm with Howard. I'm simply going to move him his 5 inches twice and get, well, I'll move up to sort of cower here behind Faye. With Harry, I'm going to take one move, 5 inches up to here. And he has a 10-inch range on his pistol, so both those guys are within range. And, well, let's move a bit closer. Right, so he's going to take a shot at this cultist. The range is within his 10 inches for his 45 handgun. The 45 handgun has a rate of 1, meaning you roll 1 dice to see if it hits. And he has to roll his dexterity of 5+. Score a hit, and I roll a 6, so it hits. Very good. Then I roll damage, which is for a 45 handgun, a d6 plus 2. Let's see what we get for that. Oops. 4. That is then compared to the constitution of the cultist, which is 5. It does not exceed that, it does not equal or exceed the constitution, and so no damage is scored. Moving on, Evelyn also has a 45 handgun, and she has line of sight, and so she's going to take 2 shots. Well, I do resolve 1 action at a time. So we do the first one. She has a better dexterity, she has a 4+. And I roll a 3, which is a miss. And so I take the second shot. That's a 5, which is a hit. So we roll damage for that. Another d6 plus 2. 5. That does, in fact, exactly equal the constitution of... Now... One corner of this terrain piece is kind of giving some cover, but I'm gonna say that's not enough to give a cover save. So, anyway, the damage exactly equals his con, so that means 1 wound. He only has 1 wound, and thus I get to roll on the injury table, which is a roll of 2 dice, and, well... Let me show you what it looks like. It looks like this. And I roll a 10, which is a major injury.
removed from the table and must roll a mage injury table. This is not really relevant for lurkers because lurkers don't come back as such anyway, so a minor or major injury is basically just dead or because it's removed. So, this guy, boom, headshot. See, the next action for the lurkers will be move to engage the model furthest from a threshold model will do a cautious advance and then to try to target threshold model with the lowest total point value, and it has plus two its movement characteristic this turn. Now
the furthest model from any threshold model is this guy over here on the edge with a knife. Now he can't get to the lowest cost model, which it would be Howard. But so I'm going to say that he's instead going to try to go for the closest, which is Harry. Now with his plus two movement, he could move a total of 14 inches, which would place him with very close to, but not exactly in contact. But I'm going to be generous. I'm going to give the lurkers the benefit of the doubt and say that he can reach there. He can do one move, and then the second move, which a move into contact into melee, is called a charge. And so we're going to resolve a melee combat.
The way melee works is you roll at the same time for both opponents to see who hits, and the dice rolled to hit is equal to the attack stat. Now, Harry here, being a threshold agent, has two dice. So I've got two greens. The cultist has only one die. So, and then what you do is you compare the highest die. The highest of the two the Harry rolls will compare to with the one that the cultist rolls. Both have knives, which give a plus one close combat modifier. So they sort of cancel out. And let me show you so you see I'm not cheating. That was a six against a three. So it's a seven against four. The difference being three, which means that Harry scored three hits. Again, we rolled to wound, and because I got three hits, I get to roll three dice. I choose the highest for the number of wounds. Well, not number of wounds, but to compare to the constitution. And the damage modifier of the knife is plus one also, so the highest of these, plus one. Ooh, so that's seven. Compared to the constitution of five means equaling constitution gives one wound and each number above adds an additional wound. So that's three wounds. And he only has one. And that means that I roll on the injury table and add two. So two dice plus two. Oh, well, 13. He's out of the running. Bye-bye, Lurker. For a threshold turn, I'm going to nominate Evelyn, of course, plus Harry, plus Howard again. Harry is going to use his accurate skill to take aim at this cultist over here, and then use his second action to shoot. And what that means is he gets a plus one to the shot. He gets more accurate. But it's not enough. He misses. Now, Evelyn, I'd say this forest, I'm going to say that the edge of this terrain piece, it's all forests. And so this guy has cover from her, which means she's going to move closer. She's going to take a 5-inch move. Move up to here. Well, something like that. And then she's simply going to take a shot. And she misses. Meanwhile, Howard there is going to start moving through the forest. Now, terrain the rule is a bit odd. What it says is that when you start moving through terrain, you get -2 to your movement. That is -2 to your movement stat, which is... Because he wants to start moving through the forest, he gets -2 movement. He only has 3 inches movement. So if he takes 2 moves, he can move six inches, which will place him around here. I'll show you. He got to there in the forest. Over to the lurkers. And ranged focus. If this model is equipped with a ranged weapon, is not engaged in close combat, must attempt to shoot an enemy model this turn, regardless of whether this class is melee or ranged. Right. So, the closest lurker to a threshold model will activate cautious movement and target the closest threshold model. Now, this means that this pistol packing lurker here will try to shoot at Evelyn. Technically, Howard is closer, but he has no line of sight. Well, or rather, there's heavy cover. I would say that's... Well, okay. Let's put it this way. A 1 to 3, he shoots at Evelyn. 4 to 6, Howard. He takes a shot at Evelyn. And there's no point in him moving, so he's going to take... let me see. He's going to take 2 shots. And his dexterity... is 5+, so let's roll. One of them hits. He rolls the damage. Sorry, I made a mistake there. He has a rate of 2 for 22 handgun, which means he rolls 2 dice for the first shot, and he got that hit. And he rolls 1 die +1 for damage, 3, nowhere near her constitution. So he takes the second shot, which is also 2 dice, and gets at best a 4, but he has a 5 dexterity, so the second shot misses. And that was unfortunately all for the lurkers. Threshold this turn, I'm going to activate Evelyn, Faye, and Howard, and I'm going to start by letting... Oh, easily within 5. Evelyn charge into close combat with this guy. She's going to beat him about the ears with her torch. Now, the torch has a 0 close combat bonus, but so does being unarmed, which is what he is because he has a gun, not a not any kind of close combat weapon. Now, Evelyn has an attack stat of 3, the cultist only of 1. So, highest roll. Well, the 6 is the highest. That hits. Well, compared to the 3, that's 3 hits. Now, the damage for a torch is 1d+1. So we're going to roll 3 dice, take the best, and add 1. That's 6. Against a con of 5 is 2 wounds. Again, he only has 2 wounds. Sorry, 1 wound, so that's rolling +1 on the injury table. Oh. But because of the +1, it gets a minor injury, and it's removed. And that sort of clears the path here for Howard, who's going to move because he's in the forest. He's gonna move another 6 inches out of it. Get to here. Let me show you. He gets to there, and oops, he is that much closer to reaching his objective. In the meantime, Faye is going to advance 5 inches and possibly shoot. Right, Faye will fire her shotgun at the cult leader. I've measured it's just within 8 inches, which is normal range. It's not within 6, so the power attribute that shotguns have does not come into play. It does more damage at closer range. Also, he has cover, but first we'll roll to see if it's a hit. Now, the rate is 1, and her dexterity, third check, because I haven't actually used her before, is 5+. It's a miss. And that ends the threshold turn for now. And the lurkers call for help. Oh, interesting. Return lowest value lurker model has been removed from play to gain in base to base with a random board edge. If no lurker models have died, blah, blah, blah. These are all the same cost. So I'm going to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This guy, random table edge. 1, 2, 3, 4, and I'll re-roll 1. So, random board edge. Yeah, let's put him. Let's make it a bit more interesting, and place him here, so he's blocking. Haha. So it's not as easy for Howard to just run off the board. Now, I'm interpreting this as an extra thing apart from the normal activation here. And this is the model furthest from a threshold. He will try to complete an objective, which is to kill the bagman. He doesn't know who the bagman is, but he might suspect now that Howard is closest to the board edge. And he's the one furthest from any threshold model is this guy. He didn't have movement to actually get there, but he moved from over here to here, getting in position, ready to do something nasty next time. And it's supposed to be a cautious advance, but there is no cover available, so whatever, he's just did 2.
Okay, threshold.
Again, I'm going to activate Evelyn and Faye and Harry. And Evelyn is going to, well, this is the henchman. He's a bit more dangerous than the rank and file cultists they've been wiping from the board so far. And since Evelyn is the most powerful of the threshold characters, she's going to take her duty seriously. And I've measured so she can do 1 move and then charge. And now let's fight this combat. Like I said, she has 3 dice. The henchman has 2. Let me have a look at the weapon table. Right, so the henchman has +1 to his best roll. She has no modifier. Oops. So this is a cocked die. I'm going to re-roll it, thankfully. So 5 against, well, it doesn't really matter because I had a 5 there anyway. 5 against 7. That's 2 hits against Evelyn with a knife which has a +1 modifier. So that's 5. But she has a constitution of 6. So she sucks that up. No problem at all. I'm not going to shoot into melee, but I've moved Faye up 5 inches, so she is within close range, which activates the power characteristic of the shotgun, meaning it does more damage and can knock back if it hits. But first off, she needs to hit. So 5+. No, she doesn't hit. Harry here will once again take aim and try to shoot this guy, which it means that he gets to a 4 up and misses. And he would have had a pretty good cover save even if there had been hit. For what they do, melee focus, if this it's the lowest point cost model, so let's see which one. We have 2 equally low point cost models, this one and this one. I'm going to roll a die. 1 to 3, it's this one.
No, it's the other one. And if it has a close combat weapon, well, it doesn't. So, no dice for you. It's going to do a cautious advance and then try to target the closest threshold model. Let's see. Okay, so the closest threshold model to him is Faye, but he's doing a cautious advance. He's going to move up to here, meaning he has cover from Harry over here, and he's going to take a shot. I think she's within range. Yeah, I think I measured that. So he has his rate of 2, and he has a dex of 5s. And so he misses. Oh well. Now a rule comes into play which we haven't actually used before, which is the very first phase of each turn is resolve combat, which is if you have any ongoing close combats that are not finished, you have to roll for those before you do anything else. So, right. We're going to go again here. Plus 1 for the best of... Oops. And... So once again, the henchman wins 7 against 5. That's 2 hits. With plus 1 for the best die. Ooh, darn. 7. That actually beats Evelyn's constitution. So it's a roll on the injury table. Now, because Evelyn actually had 2 wounds, and she took 2 wounds, she's down to 0, which means it's a straight roll on the injury table. And we get a 6. Unconscious. Place the model face down. Ouch. That's not good. And so we place it like that. Unfortunately, I think I better check the rules. Okay, so I've been reading the rules, and I realized, well, first off, I realized I've been using all the advanced rules except for the critical hits rules, but yeah, next game. Anyway, I can nominate. I thought that I couldn't nominate Evelyn because she's unconscious, but I actually can. However, all she can do currently is to change state, that is to change from first from face down to face up and then from face up to normal. But if she does that while she's in base to base with somebody, you got to fight a close combat round and she's pretty vulnerable. On the other hand, I think what I can do is I can nominate her, then group nominate Faye and Harry, and I can resolve their actions first and hope they can take out the dude. So I'm going to do that. And I'm going to take a gamble here. So, first off, Faye. Now, there is no rule for shooting into close combat that I've been able to find. However, I would say that having other combatants would grant a cover save. Normally, it would be full cover, that is a 4+. However, because Evelyn's lying down, I'm going to say she gets a 6+ cover save. She gives a 6+ cover save. If Faye hits the henchman, then I have to roll a die, and a 6+, Evelyn is hit instead. Fair enough? Okay. Let's try shooting the shotgun at the cultist. And it's a hit. And he has a 6+ cover save. Oh my god. Yeah, I'm gonna kill my own leader. This is bad. So, damage 4. Well, actually, the power stat gives it an extra +1 with close range, so it's 5. But Evelyn actually has a 6 constitution, so she's fine. She can take a shotgun blast at close quarters. I'm going to try again to shoot at the henchman and miss. Okay, then. So, next thing that happens is that Harry has charged into close combat with the henchman, and they're going to fight it out with knives. They both have knives. They both have two attacks. They both have plus one. So it's just the luck of the dice. And this time, Harry rolls three better. So he gets three hits. And the highest is a six, plus one for the knife, is a seven, against the henchman's constitution of five. That's, and he only has one wound, so that's two extra. That's plus two on the injury table. 10. Wiped out. Whew. Yeah, that was a close one. And Evelyn's going to take her two actions. First action is to change state to face up, which means in this game lying down but conscious. And then she's going to stand up to normal state. The cultists use any special abilities? Blah, blah, blah. No, nobody has any special abilities. Shuffle discards into the action deck after we're done. Okay, so highest point value, that will be the cult leader, and he's gonna group activate both of his cultists because they're actually both within 10 inches. They're gonna do cautious advances and try to complete the objective. Okay, let's see what that means. So, what that means, this guy simply moved his full movement allotment, trying to reach Howard here, didn't quite make it. The cult leader charged into combat with Harry, and this cultist over here took one move and is going to take a shot at Faye. Let's just roll for him first, that's the easiest thing. Reroll that. No, don't. Ah, miss. And anyway, I realized a few things. I forgot to use Evelyn's crack shot special skill, which gives her plus one damage when she hits with a ranged weapon. And I also forgot that Harry's accurate ability not only gives plus one to hit, which is kind of a useless use of an action, but it also negates any cover. That's why I was using it. Also, I forgot to roll for psychic abilities for all my threshold. We'll do that after the game. Anyway, let's resolve this close combat. Now, the cult leader has two attacks, and so does Harry. Harry has a knife. The cult leader has a club, which is actually a much better weapon. It has a plus two close combat bonus. It doesn't have armor piercing, which the knife does, but otherwise it's better. But so anyway, let's see here. Oh darn, so that's seven against three. That's four hits for the cult leader against poor Harry. Let's see, fortunately the club only, it has a plus one damage modifier, so that's seven. Holy crap. Harry has a con 6, so that's 2 wounds. He takes 1 wound, and then we roll with plus 1 on the injury table. We get 7, minor injury. The model is removed from the table, but may return next game fully recovered. Bye-bye, Harry. You did your job well. Well, things are looking a bit iffy. All right, threshold. I'm going to nominate Evelyn and the two remaining agents. And yeah, I'm going to try to clear a path for Howard here. So Evelyn is going to take a shot at this dude. Dex 4 plus, a hit. And now, right. So damage is a die plus 2 plus 1 for the crack shot. That's plus 3. 6 against the cultist constitution of 5 is an extra. extra wound, so that's plus one on the injury table. And seven, yeah, he's out of it. And then she's going to turn around and take a pot shot at the cult leader. Wait a minute. I rolled two shots, didn't I? It was the second shot that hit? I don't remember. No, I checked the footage and it was the first shot. So she gets to take a shot at the leader and she hits and rolls damage. Plus three. Nine. Holy. The leader has a con of six and only one wound. So that's plus three on the injury table. He should be out. Well, it's a good thing I had plus three, or he would not have been removed. But as it is, he is. And, well, let's see if Faye can finally do something with her shotgun. Is she within... She's within short range. I moved Howard his 10 inches, so he's close to escaping. I'm probably going to win this, but let's play it out just for the heck of it. Faye rolls to hit, misses the first one, and misses both her shotgun blasts. However, what are the cultists going to do? I've reshuffled the deck as per the instructions on the last card. And now he... No, there are no special abilities, so... And, well, there's not a lot that he can do. I mean, he can shoot. I mean, let's say he takes two shots at Faye. First one... actually hits, and let's roll for the second one. Second one misses. So on the one that hits, he gets plus one. So, oh, six damage. He can actually do something to her. That is exactly equal to her constitution. So a straight roll on the damage table because she only has one wound. And a nine. So she gets a major injury. Oh well. That was at least something. But now we go over to Threshold, and I nominate both our models, and he moves off. And it's a win for the Threshold! Clap, 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 hooray! So let's roll on the major injury table for Faye. Let's say that it's a D66, so let's say the green is the 10 die and the red is the 1. And we get 53 full recovery. No permanent effects today. That was pretty good. Next up is the advancement phase. Regardless of which player has won, all threshold models that were not removed due to an injury roll 1d6 and receive an advancement on a result of 6. Oh, so both Faye and Harry are ineligible. Let's roll for my leader. First, Evelyn, no. Let's roll for Howard, no. But because I won, one model may receive an automatic advancement. Yeah. So I'm gonna select. Well, let's upgrade my character. Let's upgrade Evelyn. Let's roll a die here. Maul gains a new skill, adds one personal point, requirements must always be met. You know, I'm going to choose Improved Command. That will let her nominate three other models when she's nominated, which means she can nominate the whole gang. Next up is the treasure hunting phase. If the threshold player wins the scenario, every model on the board at the end of the game may roll 1d6 to search the board for map pieces. Okay, so only Evelyn was actually on the board. No map piece was found. And however,
If we look at the actual scenario, there were some special rules there. Hang on a second. Okay. If threshold when all uninjured models will receive a map piece on a roll of 5 or 6. In addition, if the initially selected bagman successfully moves off the board without being revealed, that model discovers a map piece automatically, no roll necessary. So I should have, what did I roll? Let's roll go again. No. Still no, nothing on the roll, but I got one free map piece for completing the objective of the scenario. And then I realized I'm not as smart as I thought I was, because I can't automatically re-equip. I can only re-equip if one of my models was killed, got a result of dead, or if I lose two consecutive games. So as long as things are going well, I can't get extra equipment. Oh well. However, I am going to do a thing I forgot to do before the game and roll for psychic powers. You roll 2d6 on a 2 or a 12. The agent in question gets psychic powers. So let's start with my leader, Evelyn. Roll a 5, nothing. Harry is not psychic. Faye is not psychic either. And finally, Howard gets an 8. No psychic agents in this team. I didn't make one more change though, because I had miscalculated the ability to re-equip. I made it a little easier for myself by redistributing some points. I took away the firearm cleaning kit from Harry, which was half a point, which I decided is useless, and I used that to give Howard a 22 handgun instead, so he has some sort of weapon, because he can't go around completely unarmed. Anyway, some sort of post-mortem. How did this all pan out? Well, I actually thought it was surprisingly balanced. I thought that using the deck with a lurker list that had a commander in it would be underpowered, because using the deck straight up, I did not nominate as many lurkers as the maximum possible every turn. It was still surprisingly close. Maybe because I didn't play well, but or maybe the game is designed to be hard for the threshold. I'm not sure. But I will try as a house rule next time, just to say that if I'm playing solo against a lurker list that has somebody with a command ability, then the commander will always be nominated, and the deck will simply tell me which of his cultists he will group nominate, and also tell me the tactics they're going to use. So we'll see if that changes the balance too much or enough. I'm not sure. What else can we say? Well, as some other people have commented, close combat is much more effective than ranged, because you roll more dice. Well, let me put it this way. If you go into close combat, you can be pretty certain that something is going to happen. Somebody's going down. It's dangerous. Ranged combat has a lot more missing, a lot more whiffing going on. But on the other hand, it's safe. You're safe from retribution if you're shooting a gun. So I'm thinking maybe that is balanced. I would need to play more to get more of a feeling for it. Anyhow, that was this game. I
don't know how much work this is going to be to all edit all this together and upload it. It might be so much work that I will never do anything like this again. Or maybe I will try to continue doing some sort of battle reports. Please let me know what you thought of this. You know, this type of content, this type of video will live or die depending on what my viewers want or like. So, you know, pipe up. Anyway, I'm Dakian, and until next video, I'm signing off.